when certain things are on automatic pilot and you're just like, you're just kind of like, you know, putting paint down, you're like, oh God, I love this. I love the way it feels to just like get the brush and load it up with paint and the way it moves. Paint just moves. It's pretty incredible. It's solitary, it is not lonely. You're not alone. You're not alone. You have all the voices in your head. You have all the thoughts that are being generated with every mark you make. You have all of the work that's gone before you. You have everything. You have a whole universe right there in your studio with you. I started out with the experience that people around me drew. My mother drew, my aunts drew. My mother was always asking me to sit for her. She was asking my friends when I was 4 years old, 5 years old, 6 years old to sit, and she would draw them. And it was just something that I thought was what one did. I actually started making art seriously as a part of my life every day, just for my survival, when I was about 8 years old. My family moved from Los Angeles, Southern California, to the very cold, distant Alps of Austria. My father had decided that he was going to do something he had always wanted to do, and life had gotten in the way. World War II had gotten in the way. Having children, the family had gotten in the way.
Were the most remarkable children in the history of the United States, according to their parents.
He was going to go back to school and study medicine. And at that point, my father was 45 years old. So there were age limitations to medical school. And he found that medical school that would accept him was in Europe. And so he went to Innsbruck. And there I found myself as an eight-year-old sitting alone in this little tiny town, the only American. And I would come home from school every day and I would just sit and draw. I had a little set of watercolors and I had colored pastels and I had all kinds of things to draw with. And that's how I spent my days, and that's where I lived, was on the piece of paper. I was in a very rigid school. There was a priest who came in a couple of times a week for religious study. All the girls walked to church every Friday for confession together. So it was a very rigid environment. And the teacher who taught art also taught music. And the truth is, I can't sing. The one thing I regret in life, I cannot sing. It's true. However, I could draw even then. And when I was 8 and 9 10 11 and 12, I could really draw and I could really paint. And I remember one little painting I did in particular, and it was for Fasching, which is like carnival there. Everyone dresses up and they have very bizarre masks, and it's a period of time which is very wild. Behavior is allowed that otherwise is not the norm. It really intrigued me. And this particular time of year, what the kids did in school were pictures and costumes and Fasching and carnival. And I had this drawing and my teacher took her chalk and threw it at me. I mean, she carried over this prejudice from music to art. And I knew then, and I understood that she was approaching my art with a prejudice she had from this other area and could not see and make a judgment about it independent. And so for me, that was a life lesson, not just about one's work and one's art, but about how to approach others also, and how to make value judgments, and how to look for prejudices. And it's all linked to that one particular painting that I did, which I can conjure up in front of me without any problem. Oh, it had little dancing bears and little witches and a figure with a funny little mask. One of my early heroes was James Ensor. Came to me at a very early age with a sense of connection, not just through the art, but also through that kind of experience. James Ensor was a Belgian artist, and he did not travel that much abroad. He was, in some respect, even though he lived well into the 20th century, in terms of sensibility and his beginnings, they very much were rooted from the 19th century into the 20th century. I think that's part of being both very engaged by tradition and social convention, and also very out there and crazy. And his family had a shop by the seaside, Ostend, and they had a lot of these masks, so that his own work took the masks, seashells, everything around, and also the conventions of society, which he, from which he was able to stand apart and to look at in a very socially critical way. And I honestly, I don't remember when I first saw his work. I just remember it from the time I was very young on. With art, one has this sense of entitlement, that we can claim our own ancestors. Those whose work has spoken to us, we have this dialogue, and we time travel. And so it's not much different maybe than when Hillary Clinton spoke to Eleanor Roosevelt in the White House, you know. We're speaking to all these spirits all the time. And James Ensor was one, and Vuillard was another for me. And Vuillard's work, that I can date. I was about 12 years old when I first started looking at his paintings, and very involved and engaged by his sense of space and pattern and intimacy when I was a teenager.